그림을 같이 봐야겠어.
Nella Taoyang.
Чего, лицо-то хами.
제대로 가지고
됐다
막사키
Krachtig, hè?
Hello everyone and welcome to Theater of the Sea and to our shark and ray feeding. My name is Billy. I'm going to introduce you to all of our tropical fish, and these are all native species. You can see all of these scuba diving or snorkeling throughout the Keys. But before I tell you all about them, I'm just going to briefly tell you about the water here. Our park is landlocked, so we are not connected to the ocean or bay. About that, feel free to ask either one of us right after the show. On this side, though, we do have 7 nurse sharks, and they are considered a docile shark species. All that means, though, is if you do see one in the wild, if you leave them alone, they're going to leave you alone, too. Now, they get their name nurse because of the way that they eat, and when they eat with a powerful suction that helps them with being a bottom feeder, and one of their favorite foods is the big snail, the conch. They can rip them right out of their shell with just their suction. Now, these sharks are also trained. Whenever we call them, they're trained to come right up to this bench, as you can see, they did. And not only that, they're trained to go right to where their names are, so they're not going to random spots. For coming over, Amy is going to give them a snack, and when she feeds them, you're going to hear that suction. It sometimes makes a loud popping noise on the surface. Even though they do this, they do have teeth. Some people think they don't. They definitely do. For a shark, though, their teeth are small. Now, how they make the suction is all they're doing is opening their mouth quickly. That makes a vacuum inside and just rips out everything in front of them. Now, these sharks are not just trained to come over when called, they're also trained to allow us to touch them and handle them. We do this so we can get full visuals on their bodies. And one thing Amy's going to show us is she's going to get hands-on with one and actually flip them upside down so we can see their bellies. While flipped, if you look on their face, they also have big whiskers hanging down, or up in this case. And what those are called are barbels. It's the same whiskers catfish have. And the purpose of them is they're like little fingers they can taste with, and it helps them locate and find some of their food across the seafloor, again, where they're primarily hunting. And then, of course, in training like this, whenever an animal at the park does something correctly, they get a reward for that. So she's going to come back and give her a piece of food for that. And what we feed our sharks here is a variety of different types of fish. They also get squid, shrimp, and clams as well. And that would be pretty similar to what these guys would be catching out in the wild. Her name is Loretta. She's about a 30-year-old female, so she's quite large compared to the others. Also, like the stingrays, female sharks are typically the big ones. Now we also have a male shark up here that is older. His name is Finn. He's not nearly the size of the Loretta again. This is a male. But those are the only two mature sharks in the pool. Because of that, they could be breeding in here. And Loretta is trained for an ultrasound. How that works, at least with her specifically, is she'll often hang out with us for a long duration and let us play with her belly. That gets used to being touched by a probe. And we have done real ultrasounds with her in the past. Last time we did one, we did see eggs with her, but we have never seen breeding or babies. So what we saw in that case was just infertile eggs. And they produce that whether they're bred or not. But we still continue that daily training with her in case they ever occur here.
How long do they live?
Up to about 50 for these sharks. Other sharks have different lifespans. And she'll do the same flip too. And if you didn't notice the whiskers before, you can get a good look at them now. Now, if anyone here wanted to actually swim with sharks, you can do that here too. We have a shark program. You join us right here on these benches. We'll bring some of these guys over to you. You can hang out with them and swim with them. With that being said, though, a lot of people are already quite afraid swimming in the ocean, and that's usually because of sharks. In the ocean, though, you do have a much larger chance of getting struck by lightning than you do of being bit by rats.
Very much so. Even with bark, I look.
I'm not the
Okay. ایش تطری نخیره نزیه بیو چمک را قدیل بیار دو کارگو چنره
Introducing you guys to our sea turtles here at the park. Now here at Theater of the Sea, we have a total of 9 sea turtles. We have 5 green sea turtles, 2 loggerheads, 1 Kemp's Ridley, and 1 Hawksbill. Now we hold permits to rescue, rehabilitate, and if possible, release our sea turtles. But all of our turtles that you guys are seeing at the park today are all deemed non-releasable by the government, meaning that all of these guys are unable to live out on their own in the wild. Now the turtle that people have most questions about is that lovely lady over there with that white life jacket. Now her name is Quasimodo. Now Quasimodo was born at a sea turtle hatchery and she was born with a spinal deformity. Now with that she has something called bubble butt syndrome, which is basically just a buoyancy disorder in sea turtles. So if you guys look on that life jacket, you may notice those 2 flotation devices right on the front of it, and that's just to even out her body and even out her buoyancy so that she is able to lift up her head to come up for that air. So without that life jacket, she would be stuck at an angle and she would be unable to lift up that head for air. So if you notice, she has that life jacket, but lots of people think that she doesn't have a shell, but she does. It's just very deformed. But right on the other side of this grate over there, we have another female Hawksbill sea turtle. That's the word. Hawksbill sea turtle, and her name is Christmas, and she was struck by a boat, and that is when she got some air trapped under her shell, and that is why she has bubble butt. So she has 2 lead weights on the back of her shell, so her shell isn't that deformed, so those 2 lead weights would do work perfect for her. Now this sea turtle over here eating the lettuce off of this grate, her name is Aphrodite. Now Aphrodite was found caught up in some fishing line and she developed a really bad infection on her flippers. Now unfortunately they did have to amputate her front right and her back left flipper due to that injury and due to that infection. So she does serve as a perfect example of why we should be extremely cautious when we're out in the open water. Now also in this lagoon we have another female green sea turtle. She's quite large.
And Raven. Now there are some scientists out there that will compare a parrot's intelligence to that of the average human toddler between the ages of 2 and 4 years old. Now here at Theater of the Sea, we do love to work with this high level of thinking, whether it's through training or playing games. Both are extremely stimulating and enriching for them. Now the first game we're going to be playing this afternoon is called the Psychologist Colorform Board. Now it might look a little familiar to some of you, kind of like a child's play toy. That's because it is. But a psychologist specifically invented this game to gain the IQ of the average human toddler between the ages of 1 and 1.5 years old. Now as you can see, it's a fairly simple concept. We have the 3 different colored shapes. And of course, the corresponding spaces to which they all fit. Now, I think we're going to bring out one of our parent friends to play this first game with us. And I think Frankie is going to go ahead and grab Clover. Clover is a 40-year-old Verde macaw. Now, he is a type of hybrid species, which just means that they are a mix between 2 different types of macaw. One of them is the scarlet, and the other is a bouffon's macaw, which is also known as the grand military. Before we do get Clover started, we want to let you in on a little secret about him. So he actually believes himself to be the star of the show. That means he will expect you all to clap and cheer for him, stomp your feet, and yes, backflips if you can. Just to let him know he's doing a fantastic job. Push the board forward. Now with that being said, let's go ahead and start him off with the red square. Good boy. the yellow star, it might be a little bit more difficult for him with all the edges. We're lucky, we can twist and turn it very easily with our fingers. Now let's see what his beak can do. Good boy. Good boy, Clover. All right, second round. We're going to be mixing up the pieces to see if he can still get it into the correct spot. And once you all think they're nice and shuffled, you can go ahead and yell out. Oh, never mind. He's ready to go. All right, he's got the circle. Clear. Oh, okay. And star. Good boy, Clover. All right. These are called zygodactyl feet, and they are very uncommon in the bird world. Now, a lot of other perching birds that you'll see will have three toes in the front and one toe in the back. Barrel. Now, right away, you will notice those zygodactyl feet that we just talked about are giving him the wide, firm, and steady grip he needs to hold on to that barrel. Those short little legs are getting in the low center of gravity that helps keep them nice and balanced. You can imagine an ostrich, flamingo, myself with a one leg would not be able to do this very well. Now you might also notice in order to move the barrel forward, Clover is taking steps backwards. Now walking backwards is a training behavior because out in the wild you may see an animal take a step backwards to avoid some danger. Very
Can you? It's warm and bright. We can dance.